A lot of people will probably be thinking this morning and maybe tomorrow and maybe sometime during what we sometimes call the holiday season about Jesus and about his birth especially. There's a lot that's pretty fascinating and incredible but truthful to think about Jesus' birth. Sometimes we focus on the fact that it was a virgin birth, but at least in my opinion, something even more incredible, perhaps by far, is that it was what it says up here on the screen, the incarnation of the great I Am. It was the Creator stepping into the creation, which is an incredible thing to think about. There's a song that we've sung together when we've met for Bible study the past couple Wednesday nights that, to me, sort of brings home the idea of the incarnation. The song is called Mary, Did You Know? I think it's, at least in my opinion, one of the most beautiful songs ever written because it makes the incarnation real by inviting us to consider it from the perspective of someone who was there, of someone who was closer to that miracle and that event maybe than anyone else, which is Mary. Can you imagine what it would have actually been like to be Mary, to actually be the mother of the Savior, of the Word made flesh? And there's some lyrics in that song that sort of bring that to light as well. I think the sort of a play on words where it says, this child that you've delivered will soon deliver you. It's an amazing thing to think about. There's another line that sort of inspired this title and this topic of consideration this morning when it says, this sleeping child you're holding is the great I Am. And it is such a contrast in your mind to think of a small sleeping child or to think of the great I Am, who is the source of existence and the source of everything that is good and beautiful. And to think that these are coexisting in one place in a special way is an incredible thought. So that's what I'd like to consider this morning. We know that the idea of the great I Am goes back to Exodus chapter 3, when Moses is meeting God with the burning bush. And Moses said to God, behold, I'm going to the sons of Israel, and I will say to them, the God of your fathers has sent me to you. Now they may say to me, what is his name? What shall I say to them? God said to Moses, I am who I am. And he said, thus you shall say to the sons of Israel, I am has sent me to you. Now, a lot of times in Scripture, there is a symbolic nature to naming something. Often when you name something, you're expressing ownership or mastery or understanding of that thing. And I think that's why Moses can't name God but has to ask God what his name is. You know, some other nation with a made-up God who makes an idol can give it whatever name they want, but Moses can't do that because God created Moses, not the other way around. And so Moses is here asking God what his name is. And our names also tend to say something about us, at least often, especially in Scripture. A name might be given for some symbolic reason or to mean something about the person. Or as someone got older and exhibited a certain character, they might even have a name that applied to their character. But what name can you possibly give to God? I mean, yes, the Jews had this generic word, God, which could apply basically to an idol as well as to the true God, and it just conveyed the idea of divinity. But as far as a proper name, what name, proper name, could you give to God? Because any name that emphasized something about him would leave out something else. It's like there's no human language that is sufficient to give a name to God. So the name of sorts that he gives is I Am. Many have seen a philosophical or a spiritual significance to that and suggest that it means that God is the only being whose reason for his existence is within himself. He's the final answer to the question of why things exist. You can always ask, well, why did that happen? And why did that happen? And why did that happen? And eventually, you just have to say, just because of God. Well, why is God there? Just because God is. Eventually, you come to the conclusion that he is, and his name is I Am. It's incredible to think then that he's the source of everything that exists. that he is completely and perfectly good and beautiful and truthful. So that's where the idea of I am comes from. Is it accurate to say that Jesus was the great I am, that Mary held within her arms the great I am? It must be, because John frequently in his gospel applies I am to Jesus. The words I am appear 24 times in John's gospel. And that's not surprising, because John is the writer who emphasizes the deity of Jesus Christ more than perhaps the other gospel writers do. And I am is the name of the one true God. So you see in John 8:56 through 58, Jesus is speaking to the Jews, and he says, "Your father Abraham rejoiced to see my day, and he saw it and was glad." So the Jews said to him, "You are not yet 50 years old, and have you seen Abraham?" Jesus said to them, "Truly, truly, I say to you, before Abraham was born, I am." You notice clear enough in English that he's invoking the special name of God. But it's likely that since Jesus was speaking to Jews, he was speaking to them in Aramaic. And they were familiar with the word for God's name being the same as I am in their language. So it may have been even more obvious to them than it is to us that he is claiming to be the Lord. And then again in John 18 and throughout John, there are several statements that we will look at where they're called the I am statements of Jesus, where he says, "I am the bread of life," or "I am some particular thing." But there are also times when he simply says, "I am." One of them that isn't here on the screen is when he's out walking on the water and his apostles see him and are afraid. And he says, "Do not fear, I am." And, you know, many translations will translate it as, "It is I," or something like that. But what he was really saying was, "I am." And it comes up a lot in John's gospel. And that's the case with John 18, which we had read this morning, verses 3 through 6. So Judas then, having received the Roman cohort and officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. So Jesus, knowing all things that were coming upon him, went forth and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus the Nazarene." He said to them, "I am he." And you might notice, if you look in a printed Bible, often "he" will be in italics, because italics are often used to represent words and translations that weren't there in the original, but have been added to make it perhaps more clear or more understandable. But Jesus is literally saying, "I am." And Judas also, who was betraying him, was standing before them. So when he said to them, "I am he," or "I am," they drew back and fell to the ground. It's often perceived as remarkable when you read through here and you think, why would they fall to the ground because of him saying, "I am he"? Were they shocked that he had said that, or by what was going to take place? Or was there some supernatural event that occurred that knocked them down, almost like the shockwave goes out? I don't know for sure, but it is an impressive thought to think of him saying, "I am," of invoking this name of God on himself, and of them hearing it and drawing back and falling to the ground. So yes, it is accurate to say that Jesus is the great I am. And John helped us think about what that means, especially in the opening chapter of his gospel. He says in John 1:3, "All things came into being through him, and apart from him nothing came into being that has come into being." And then to build on that, verse 10 says, "He was in the world, and the world was made through him, and the world did not know him." So think how sort of ironic of a situation it is, or what a powerfully thought-provoking situation it is, that the great I am, comes into the world and walks in the world he created, and he's not recognized. You know, people see him and they don't realize who it is. And then verses 14 through 16, where it says, "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we saw his glory, glory as of the only begotten from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified about him and cried out, saying, 'This was he of whom I said, he who comes after me has a higher rank than I, for he existed before me.' For of his fullness we have all received, and grace upon grace. All of us have received our very being from him, and he became flesh and dwelt among us. So it's no wonder that John said, he must increase, but I must decrease. Because who is John compared to the Word become flesh? Now there's lots of different ways, different angles perhaps, to look at the Incarnation, to try and wrap your mind around what it means that Jesus could be both God and man. And how is that possible? And what are the implications of that? There's one illustration that is used from time to time that is a very interesting way of looking at it that might help us think about it this morning. And that's the idea of an author who writes themselves into the story, which is something that actually happens sometimes in our world. Sometimes authors will write themselves as a character in their own story. And because, you know, a story, a book, is obviously, in some sense, less real than the reality that we live in. And you can think about it the same way with God in our world, that God existed before us and he created us and he has control over the whole situation. And it is ultimate reality, whereas we don't know everything, we don't see everything, we're just in the story that he's written. It may not be a perfect metaphor, but it's an interesting way of considering it. And there's a man named Timothy Keller who mentions a specific instance of a person writing themselves into a story that could be comparable to the Incarnation. He says, Dorothy Sayers wrote a series of detective novels focused on her fictional character, Lord Peter Wimsey. Sayers' creation, Wimsey was an aristocrat detective from the 1930s who solved all kinds of crimes. She wrote a whole series of stories and novels about Lord Peter. Then about halfway through her Wimsey detective series, a woman suddenly shows up in the novels. Sayers' new character is named Harriet Vane, a female mystery writer and one of the very first women to get through Oxford. Harriet and Peter fall in love. Until that point in the series, Wimsey was an unhappy, broken bachelor, until Harriet Vane shows up and her love starts to heal his broken soul. It's interesting because Dorothy Sayers, like her fictional character, was one of the first women to graduate from Oxford. Like Harriet Vane, Dorothy Sayers was a writer of mystery novels. Dorothy Sayers looked at her character, Lord Peter Wimsey, and saw that he needed someone to help him out. So who did she put in there? A detective novelist, a woman, and one of the first women to go through Oxford. Who was that? She put herself into her own stories. She looked into the world that she had created, and she fell in love with her chief character, Peter Wimsey, and she wrote herself into that story so she could heal him. And there have been others as well. C.S. Lewis and Stephen King were a couple other examples I found of people who have written either novels or whole series in which they became characters in their own stories. It's kind of hard to imagine what it would be like if you could actually go into the story, I guess, that you had written and be a part of it. But in a sense, that's what God did when he came and took human form, when the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And it kind of drives home the miracle of what was occurring there. Hebrews is another book that considers the Incarnation and speaks of it in different ways. And there is some additional information here in Hebrews 2, 10 and 11, and then 14 through 18. It says, it was fitting for him, for whom are all things, and through whom are all things, in bringing many sons to glory, to perfect the author of their salvation through sufferings. For both he who sanctifies and those who are sanctified are all from one Father, for which reason he is not ashamed to call them brethren. So it refers to Jesus Christ as the author of our salvation. And yet, it also speaks of him as one whose work is being perfected through sufferings. That is, he's the author of our salvation, but he's also one who came and suffered alongside us to bring our salvation into existence. And it goes on to say, since the children share in flesh and blood, he himself likewise also partook of the same. So it wasn't as if he just always naturally had flesh and blood, but he partook of it. He became flesh to go and be among us to perfect the work of our salvation through suffering. It says that through death he might render powerless him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and might free those who through fear of death were subject to slavery all their lives. For assuredly he does not give help to angels, but he gives help to the descendants of Abraham. Therefore he had to be made like his brethren in all things, so that he might become a merciful and faithful high priest in things pertaining to God, to make propitiation for the sins of the people. For since he himself was tempted in that which he suffered, he is able to come to the aid of those who are tempted. So it seems like no ordinary person could have been the ultimate high priest for us. No ordinary person could have ultimately been a mediator between man and God. We needed Jesus, who could be the Word and yet who could be flesh. And so he could come and partake of that with us and suffer alongside us and give us salvation the only way we could have it. It's kind of like if you think about that illustration of an author writing themselves into the story. It's like the author knows that they have what the characters need and write themselves into it so that then they themselves can give the characters what they need. And so God looked down and he loved us and he saw what we needed. We needed someone who could bring our salvation about by suffering alongside us. And then he did that for us. And when you think about even just the meaning of I am, which we described, of the great I am being someone on whom we are all dependent for our very existence, and then you think about how no one else could have given salvation to us unless he had written himself into the story, so to speak, you realize how we haven't done anything to deserve any of it, that it's a gift that he's just given, motivated by love to us. And when you look at the I am statements that Jesus made, some of these I am statements in John, they are things that we couldn't have found anywhere else, that he gave us because he was gracious to us. And so for time's sake, I may just read the underlined portions here, but he said to us, I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the gate. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the way, the truth, and the life. And I am the vine. And I'd like to take a few moments to consider each one of these as an expression of God's grace, as him doing something for us that we couldn't have done for ourselves, that he did out of love when he came into the world for us. And that kind of brings up another concept that's common at this time, which is a gift. Often we exchange gifts this time of year alongside our consideration of what God has done for us. And maybe that's good, because giving gifts reminds us to be grateful. You know, a gift is especially impacting sometimes if someone gives us something that we could not have obtained for ourselves, or something that we needed that they were able to give us. And so I want to think about these things that he has given to us. And it was a gift, and it is something he has given. For instance, John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. The incarnation was an act of giving by God. Romans 6:23 says, the wages of sin is death, but the free gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. And that's what makes something a gift, right? Is that you don't have to pay for it, but that you're just given it. Ephesians 4:7 through 8 says, to each one of us, grace was given according to the measure of Christ's gift. Therefore, it says, when he ascended on high, he led captive a host of captives, and he gave gifts to men. In the context of Ephesians, it's especially talking about these gifts of different ways that we can serve in his kingdom. It does highlight the basic concept of him giving of himself and giving in the incarnation to us. So I'd like to consider these one at a time as gifts, just briefly to consider these seven I am statements and how he has shown grace to us and condescended, you could say, to our level to be made flesh to give to us something that we couldn't have gotten anywhere else. It's kind of an interesting way to look at gifts, because we were actually talking recently about gifts and how maybe we're sometimes a little bit, well, selfish or greedy, because we want to receive things as gifts that we didn't actually need, because we just expect to get the things we need anyways. So like a kid who gets clothes complains because he wants his parents to buy him clothes on a normal day and buy him something special on Christmas. But you don't really have the luxury of turning your nose up at a gift because it's something you need, when it's something you need that you can't get any other way. And that's what he did for us. And I think that's kind of highlighted by the first I am statement here. I am the bread of life. You know, bread is something basic that you need for sustenance. And bread is just something that can get you by from day to day. But the bread of life isn't something we could have gotten from anyone else but Jesus. I mean, he gave his body to justify us and to sanctify us. There's no other way for that to happen. Maybe something like a more modern day equivalent of that that comes to mind is the old timey gift of oranges to people who lived in cold climates, because it would help them get nutrition that they actually needed through the winter months, that would actually help them to be healthy. And so maybe that's some small shadow of what Jesus did when coming to give us the bread of life. But it's giving us something that we need that can help us to be sustained. The next statement is, I am the light of the world. And light has a very symbolic place in Scripture and in human thinking as something that gives us understanding or knowledge or wisdom. Perhaps a modern day gift like that would be an educational book, something that can tell you what you need to know in order to do what you want to do. Jesus gives us the most useful information of all. He gives us the information we need to find God and to know the truth. You know, I'm so grateful that he did what he did. I'm also grateful that he gave us the words to tell us about it, to show us information that we never would have found otherwise. He said, I am the gate, which conveys the idea of access. A gate is something that you can go through to get to a place where you want to go. A modern day example might be movie tickets. Someone could give you movie tickets and then you could use those to get access to a movie. But of course, with Jesus, we gain access to salvation itself, to a life full of the Spirit and the fruit of the Spirit, such as love and peace and joy. And there's no other gate but him. He is the way that we can get that access. He said to us, I am the good shepherd. And a shepherd is someone who provides security and guidance to the sheep. We don't often give each other gifts that are primarily focused on security and guidance, but we do like to spend time with family. And part of that core family dynamic is the idea that parents will provide security and guidance to children. And maybe that's the closest example we have. We all need someone to show us how to live and how to grow. And maybe for a child, perhaps for a time, a parent can do that. But what about an adult? What about all of us? Ultimately, Jesus is our shepherd. And he's a good shepherd. He's someone who we can trust to give us security and guidance. He said, I am the resurrection and the life. Life itself. It's a gift that no one but the author of life could give. In our world, maybe the closest thing would be the gift of a costly medicine that we needed to prolong our lives, or a vital organ donation. But even then, we would be forestalling a death that would come later. With Jesus, we're given the gift of eternal life. And once again, it's a gift that no one could give except him. The next I am statement was that I am the way, the truth, and the life. But similar to the statement that I am the gate, you think about access to something. If he's the way to God, he can help convey us to God as transportation, maybe like a like a bicycle or a car, something to get us from point A to point B. But in all of these, I hope you see a recurring theme that Jesus is greater than any present that you will receive for Christmas this year, because no physical object in this world could serve as a vehicle to get you to God, as a way to travel to God, because God is not just some physical location, but he's spirit. And so Jesus is the way and the truth and the life. He's the way to get to the Father. And the last I am statement here is, I am the vine. And a vine is something that gives ongoing, continual support and nourishment to the branches that are connected to it. Maybe not so often as a Christmas present, but often when people are asking for help or support from someone else, they'll ask for ongoing support instead of a one-time gift, maybe month by month, to receive some kind of financial help to do something. Jesus offers us the ongoing gift of spiritual nurture and support forever. That it's not just a one-time event when you encounter Jesus, but it's something that he will do for you as long as you need for eternity, ultimately. So here's these I am statements that he's made. The great I am came into our world and spoke to us, I am, and not just I am, but I am these things that you need that you couldn't have gotten anywhere else. I am extending this grace to you to save you, not on the merit of how great you are, but out of love for you. And I compared these gifts Jesus gave to oranges, books, movie tickets, parental love, an organ donation, a car, or a pledge for monthly support, monthly financial support. But of course, all these comparisons, and some more than others, fall short of the gift of God. All of those things could be given or obtained over the course of a lifetime from various sources. But for us, there's no way to get spiritual gifts without God writing himself into our story. It wouldn't be a happy thing to celebrate if we could only give each other physical gifts, but there was no Savior to give us eternal life, eternal support and guidance and love and salvation. So he's absolutely necessary for us. And that kind of emphasizes one last aspect of gifts, which is that we really appreciate personal gifts. Now, we appreciate things that can just be bought at a store and given, but we also appreciate things that maybe are handmade or that only that person could have known that we wanted or could have created for us, and only God could have done these things for us. If he decided not to send salvation, no one else could have provided it, and so it's personal for him and for us. He really has given us something out of love for us. You know, the image of unwrapping a present is an image that we've probably used before occasionally, because it is an image that applies a lot of ways to baptism. How do you convey the idea that something is a gift that you do not earn, that you do not merit, and yet there is something that you do to receive it? And that's sort of like unwrapping a present. You don't deserve the present because you unwrapped it. You didn't earn it because you did the work of tearing the paper off. In fact, you would typically give a present that was wrapped to someone who was fairly easily physically capable of just opening it, and it wouldn't be a big deal. And being submersed in water is about the most passive, easy thing for most people to do, and something that can be arranged easily for us. And so if you'd like to respond to the invitation to open that gift this morning, or if we can help you in any other way, then you can come as we stand and sing together.